is just about that thick full of how God has answered prayers over the last few years. So, you might want your name there? Okay, so we just love to pray for you, okay? Okay. Do you know your neighbor yet? Okay. Okay. Well, I hope by the end of the message you will. We're going to be looking at something today, the greatest story ever known. And the question that we've been asking, a lot of questions in the last 6 weeks, is we're going to ask this one today: who will roll away the stone for us? Let me give you a quote from Billy Graham. You know, know who Billy Graham is? Okay. You don't know me, John Urban Billy Graham. Check this quote out. The entire plan for the future has its keys in the resurrection. Every scholar that you come across as a true biblical scholar, they're going to announce this to you. And they're going to say this, that the resurrection is the apex, it's the centrality. It is the basic foundation of Christianity today. Now think about that. If Jesus said, and he did often, he said that on the third day he's going to rise, the fulfillment was all in him. If he had not done that, even though he might be a good teacher, he would be a liar. So he's really not a good man because he's a liar. He lied about this. He's not who he says he was. So perhaps several weeks ago, we looked at maybe Jesus was a lunatic, and we ruled that out and know that he is the truth, and he is the way, and he is the life, and no man comes unto the Father except through him. And so this statement that Billy Graham makes, that most of you know who Billy Graham is and how to respect it, you understand that what Billy Graham is saying is that our future, our hope, is all determined about this thing called the resurrection of Jesus. And so when I think about that and I reflect on that, and I've had a lot of time to do that this week, I realize that the centrality of everything that we do in this church and everything that I do in my life as a follower of Jesus Christ all revolves around this truth and this fact and the reality of it in my life and what I do with it every day of my life simply is, did Jesus really arise from the dead? And I say, yes, he did. And because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that determines my future, that determines my tomorrow, that determines if I have hope in whatever I do. Are you all understanding that?
Absolutely.
And so everything is hinged, all of Christianity is hinged on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I want to share that today. Now, we've had a great time of celebration, and man, I really am so glad you're here. You know, there's several different kinds of groups here. You know, and I'm not going to label or anything like that, but I'm going to go ahead and label you. But anyway, there are those here that come every Sunday, and how you do? You know, y'all here, y'all just show up. I mean, we have work day, you show up. We have Be Nice to Gary Day, and y'all show up. And so every time we have something in our church, you've got to just show up. So there's a group here that, you know, I know your faces, I know your social security, I know your blood type, I know where you live, I know what you can cook, and I definitely know what you can't cook. I know all these things about you. And some of you are here that friends have invited you to come here. Today somebody called, hey, come to church with us today. They picked up the phone, they called and say, come on, come in. You know, come listen today. Come celebrate this thing. And man, you've got good friends, by the way. You know that? Your friends invited you. Good that you're a good friend, and good that your friends invited you, and bless the Lord that you've got your friends. And then there's some of us that, you know, say, well, it's Easter here. You know, Easter, we're kind of supposed to make a show up in church. And, you know, and I get that. And that's, I love it here. There's millions of people that are coming today that just, hey, it's Easter. I'm supposed to go to church. Because we're all searching. All of us in this room, we have this quest and we want to know God. And we want to be known by God. And we're all kind of in this together, right? You know, we're all here together just to say, man, what is this Jesus? What is this resurrection? And Easter here. And some of you are seekers this morning. Man, listen to this. You're here today and you said, man, I've got issues. And if you only knew some issues in my life, and man, you got to understand, I need help in my life. That's probably all of us in this room, right? Now, here's the one thing that we all have in common. Check this out. We all have this one thing in common. Really? You ready? You're here right now. Okay. And you're breathing. Okay. Nobody's asleep. Yeah, nobody's asleep. We're all here together. Okay, this is kind of a level ground here this morning, okay? There's no condemnation, there's no judgment in this room. I'm so glad you're here today. And I've been praying how to preach this thing to you so that we get it. Some of you are seekers here today. You mean you just want to know, what is this? And there's something missing in my life today. And I've got to have this. What is it? preaching when I was 17 years old. That's young, ain't it? And I was kind of thinking about this, and I've preached almost 30 Easter messages. No wonder I'm tired. Almost 30 Easter messages I've preached. And I thought about, what's my favorite Easter message? You want to hear that? Don't you want to hear that? My favorite Easter message was my first one. Let me tell you why. I was so excited about the opportunity that there was going to be a group of people that would hear me explain the resurrection. I was 17 years old. We did a sunrise service in Monaghan Sandhills at sunrise. It was ugly. It was so cold. It was freezing cold. The guy played the guitar and tuned his guitar several times. But we went up there and we placed this huge cross, even bigger than this, the tree kind of bigger enough. We placed it in the sand. We determined where the sunrise was going to come up. And right when the sunrise came up, we were singing. And I got up and preached. And that was my favorite message. I have no idea what I said. I was scared to death. But I was 17 years old. There was about 20, 30 people there. And I preached about you. That was my favorite Easter message. Until today, but now. Today, I'm so excited to tell about that. You know, there's pressures in preaching, you know, especially Easter, you know. I mean, you know, think, just walk in my shoes for a minute. I mean, there's a lot of pressure here, you know. I mean, I don't know how many people out there. Not more.
No.
No, okay. What's that? Okay, anyway. I don't know what that was, but we'll pray for you later. Anyway, and so all of a sudden, you know, it's here, and you know, and some of you know, and you say, well, it's Easter. I go to church once a year, and I'm thinking, I wonder if I can say the right thing that maybe they'll come maybe three times a year or four times a year. You know, the pressure is maybe I can say something that will stir them up, and they'll start coming to church. Yeah, you know. And then there's pressure on others. You know, you kind of come once a year, and you know, it's a good thing to come. And you know, so I'm thinking, man, once a year, this better be a good sermon, because this is the only sermon they're going to hear all year. You know, so there's some pressure there, you know. And then there's pressure that maybe a friend or a spouse invited you, maybe your spouse has been hounding you for a week now, saying, you better come with me to church. We're going to church today. And you're thinking back there, yeah, Joe raised his hand, you know. That's what happened to me. I had New Year this morning. But anyway, and so, you know, your spouse hounded you, and you said, man, I wonder how long this guy's going to be. You know, I saw the cookies out there. Oh, they're good. You know, I'm going to get some and get through this thing. And I know you're thinking of a lot of different things there, okay? And so there's a lot. As I stand before you, there's a lot of pressure here. And I call that peeping. Pressure of the preacher. That's what I call it. I just call people preacher pressure. I read yesterday about this guy from Ohio. He's a Baptist minister. And I'm going to tell you about the pressure, you know. And so I'm sure he's sitting in his office like I did, you know, saying, man, what am I going to say today? What difference can I make in all these people that I don't know? How can I make a difference in their life? How can I just catch this and get it? Like so many of us have got it in this room. So I know this preacher, he's thinking that. And he discovered that what he was going to do was something really radical. And what he did was this. He said, I'm going to bury myself for 3 days. I'm going to bury myself and I'm going to put myself in a casket for 3 days. And at 3 a.m. on Sunday, that's the time of the resurrection, I'm going to come out of the casket. He dressed the part, he was going to dress the part and all this. And so he started getting all this criticism. And so he said, okay, I won't do the casket for 3 days, but I'm going to do the tent. So I guess he's been in the tent, you know, for 3 days now. And so this morning at 3 a.m., when y'all were sound asleep and I was up praying for you, maybe. And so he got out of the tent and he was dressed with a long robe or whatever and some crown on his head and all these things. So, you know, and I kind of understand that, you know, there's pressure to preach, you know, like kind of an Easter sermon I've kind of done that because on Thursday I fell down a flight of stairs. And so I've been in bed for 3 days. So I've been kind of in my tomb for about 3 days. In bed. I don't do bed very well. And so I've been laid up for a while. You know, my knees are resting. But I'm good now. So just a warning. But so I kind of understand what this guy's going through. But today, what we're going to do is we're going to expose some truth. And so here's my thought. Here's all this to say this. Here's the one thing that I want. Pressure aside, illustrations aside, Funny stories aside, here's what I really want you to do. I want you to know that following Jesus is the greatest experience you'll ever have in your life. And I want to encourage everyone today, if you walk away from these doors, that you'll say, you know what, he told me, the greatest thing about the story is to follow Jesus, to love him with all your heart and all your soul. Let's pray before we begin. Lord, again, we love you, we trust you in all things. I pray today that you'll speak through me. Lord, you're amazing. All this week, you know, the pressure and the tension of saying the right thing, and it's come down to this, that you speak through me. It's a miracle. It's a miracle you use, and so I'm grateful for that. Lord, would you speak to hearts and lives that are here? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, actually, every Sunday we talk the truth about the resurrection of Jesus. We talk about this, we display this in communion about the resurrection of Jesus. And all the stories in the Bible point to the resurrection of Jesus. Do you remember a guy named Lazarus? You know, this guy named Lazarus, sorry about that. You know Lazarus? Lazarus is this guy that just, he kind of crashed and died, you know? And Jesus shows up. And here's what Jesus said. This interesting thing about this story here. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. And who believes in me, though yet he's dead, he will live. And then he turns and y'all believe this? And they did. So here's what I'm trying to say, that everything that we do in the Christian community, everything that I do in my life is focused on this relevant truth, and that's this, that Jesus is the resurrection. And every story that I read about him, and every teaching that I see about him, and all the Old Testament we talked about last week about the fulfillment of the atonement of God, is all about Jesus is the resurrection and he is the life. Amen? Amen? So we're going to dive into this morning. So that's just the introduction. Wow. We're going to look at this morning. We're going to look at the greatest story ever known. And we're going to ask this question, who will roll the stone away for us? For the last 6 weeks, some of y'all have not been here. You know, we've got a webpage. You can read that. None of you are going to do that. But anyway, I just thought I'd say that. My secretary always say that every time. But anyway, we have a webpage. You can look at this. So for 6 weeks, we've been looking at questions. We've been looking at some questions like, does my life really have meaning? We looked at one that said, is Jesus really God? We looked at some like, why do we have the Bible? And why is there pain and suffering? And then last week we looked at this one, does God really forgive sin? And we looked at the atonement and how that atonement is God's providence of grace and forgiveness. Next Sunday I'm going to talk about this. Can we really know God personally? I would encourage you to be there. Can we really know God personally? God of creation, God of the world, God has set all this into motion. Can I really, is this God just way up there and I'm just way down here? And can I really know God personally? I'm going to answer that question next week. All right. Mark chapter 16. You got a Bible? There's one in front of you. If you don't have one, if you don't own a Bible, we'd love for you to take that one home. That's not being a thief because I've invited you to take it. All right, so just take that Bible. We'd love for you to have that Bible and take it. So Mark chapter 16, we're going to dive into this thing. And I'm not sure if this is called a sermon or preaching or whatever, but it's a narrative story that I want to tell today. It's kind of this narrative story about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, we're going to tell this in a story format. And so if you notice that every story or movies that you go to have a setting. You ever been to Star Wars? You know, I'm not a Star Wars guy, but the one thing about Star Wars is they kind of loosened me at the very first, because at the beginning of Star Wars, it scrolls down about 5,000 words describing the setting and what's going on. That's why I'm not a Star Wars fan, because I don't like to read that stuff, you know? And so it just scrolls down this, but what that's doing is, in the Star Wars movies, it's setting up the setting. It's setting up the background, and that's what I want to do, because every good story has a good setting, and this is a good story. So let me tell you what's going on here. It's when we come to Mark chapter 16, here's the chronological order of what's going on. This is the Sunday after the crucifixion of Jesus on Friday. You got that? That's called Easter Sunday. That's why we're here. And so let me talk about the previous Sunday. The previous Sunday, what happened was Jesus came in to Jerusalem. It's called the Triumphal Thing. It's called Palm Sunday. Last Sunday, we had the kids come down with palms, and we celebrate that time. So the Sunday before, where we're talking about in Mark chapter 16, we know that Jesus has come into Jerusalem. Jerusalem is his holy city. And so Jesus has been there for a while before this happens in Mark chapter 16. Now, we understand that Jerusalem is a very religious town. And when Jesus shows up, immediately there's conflict, there's confrontation going on. There's a lot of religious folks there. The Pharisees approach Jesus and say, what authority do you have speaking the way that you do? You know, the chief priests, they come to him and say, what about taxes, Jesus? How do you feel about this? And the Sadducees are the ones that did not believe in the resurrection at all. And they questioned Jesus about this thing called resurrection. They didn't believe that. That's why they're called sad. You see. That is really funny out there. I don't know what you're doing. So this conflict of all the religious folks are coming against Jesus. Then Thursday night comes, and Jesus gathers his followers together. And they celebrate this time. Jesus washes their feet. Oh, just a great thing. And they celebrate the Passover feast. And he tells them, he says, from now on, when you take this bread, it's going to reflect and symbolize my body that was broken for you. Don't ever forget this, guys, what I'm about to do. He knew that Calvary was relevant. He took the cup, and he says, from now on, when you take this cup, it's my blood that was shed for you. There's no forgiveness of sin without the shedding of blood. And so, guys, y'all are going to know this later. You don't understand this now, but you're going to understand this later. He's talking about you will fully have this mystery known to you after the resurrection. That's what he's saying. He says, you don't understand now, but you're going to get this. So every time you do this, and so you remember after that, Jesus goes to the garden, he's arrested, and then the trial, and then on Friday, he's crucified. And that night, he's laid in this tomb where we pick this story up at that point. All right? And so, this is where we kind of pick this up. The text, Mark chapter 16, verses 1 and 2. Let me read this to you. And when the Sabbath, now let me just stop right there. When the Sabbath, you know that's Saturday. That's in Hebrew. That was the celebration on the Sabbath, was the Hebrew word for Sabbath. And that was expressed on Saturday, not Sunday. Because after the resurrection, everything changed. Right. Okay, Gary. Well, it comes up so we understand it. So when the Sabbath was over, and we understand that this is Sunday. You know, God loves numbers, doesn't he? In fact, he wrote a book called Numbers. Oh, y'all are so smart. And God wrote a book called Numbers, and he loves numbers. Well, let me just show you something real quick. I won't take too long, but I just kind of thought of it this morning. So this day right here in this text is on Sunday, right? And Jesus came into Jerusalem on Sunday. So Sunday all the way to Saturday, that's 7 days. And then you add one day, this is Resurrection Sunday, and that's one more day. 7 plus 1 is, there it is eight. Eight is the number for new beginnings. Got that? Who said it real slow? Eight is the number for new beginnings. God loves numbers, right? So this is the 8th day. This is what Easter's all about. It's a new beginning. Aren't you glad? I don't know about you, but I really like that part. A new beginning. Because I don't like what happened in the past. I don't like what happened yesterday. You know. But I really like the new beginnings. So this is the number for new beginnings. And my friend, that is Easter. Okay. So when the Sabbath was over, here, this video, we see a couple of Marys there. Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James or Jacob. And then Salome brought these spices. And their duty was to do this. Because remember when Jesus was after he was crucified, they took him from the cross. And the Roman guards, who wanted to guard the body, afraid that something might happen, they would steal him. And so they took him in the tomb. And the Roman guards are the one, these Gentiles, took him into the tomb. And they sealed it. And they put these centurions to guard this. And so there was never given an opportunity for the ladies to anoint him with spices and just to prepare his body. And the next day was their Sabbath, Saturday, and they didn't do anything on that day. And so they waited until Sunday, the first day of the week. All right. And so we see what's happening. They come, and they're bringing spices. Look at verse 2 there. And very early on the first day of the week, which is Sunday, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. Now, it doesn't really show that in this translation, but let me kind of explain something what's going on there. And that's it. Very early in the Hebrew clock of time, if you would, that very early simply meant it was from 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. Now listen, this is kind of cool. From 3 a.m. to 6 a.m., it was still dark outside. Y'all know that? You know, when I was up praying for you at 3 a.m. this morning, and it was dark outside, you know, and I wake up every morning at 3 a.m. for months now. I'm not sure why. So I just pray. And so from 3 a.m. to 6 a.m., it's dark. But this is the time that they get up. Anybody an early riser in this room? Anybody like to get up early? No need to repent. Anyway, who wants to get up that early? I just wake up because I wake up. I want to. But I just do that. And for y'all that like to, how many of y'all like to sleep in? There we go. There's my piece. Okay. Now, look here, I have to ask this question, though. I mean, it's in the Bible, okay? I mean, forever written. And so I've got to ask this question. Why did God want them to go so early in the morning? I mean, that's early. I mean, you know, in their minds, well, listen to me, I'm not being disrespectful, but in their minds, they knew Jesus wasn't going anywhere. They saw him dead. And so why so early? That's my question. And I kind of looked down and I'm like, man. And I think God said something here. I mean, because I think all of this revolves around this getting up early. And here's what I kind of come up with, is that this symbolizes the end of one day and the beginning of a new day. Did y'all get that? I did not get the response I wanted on that day. Here's what God is saying here. Let's look at 3-6. That is the end of one day and the what? Beginning of a new day. And so here's what I really think God is telling this great, great, great story to us. That God is the only one, when he tells a story, God is the only one that can take a seemingly conclusion and make it into an introduction. Nothing? Man, that's pretty cool. What looks like the end, God says, no, that's the beginning. What we think is the end of things, God says, no. That's the beginning. And that's why they got up early, because that was the end of one day and the beginning of a new day. And that's what Easter is all about. It's the end of that age and the beginning of this new dawn, this new day at Christ. Listen, when Jesus was hanging on the cross in John chapter 19, verse 30, when Jesus was hanging there, do you remember the last words that he said? Do you remember what he said? He said, "It is finished." Let me tell you what that was. First of all, that wasn't these words of saying, well, I'm done, I'm out of here. You know, this life is over with. I'm never going to be this life again, so I've died. I'm taking my last breath, and it's finished. I'm done. I'm not coming back here. That's not what he's doing there. You know what he's really saying? He's making this announcement of completion. That what he's done in his life, he's completed the work of his Father. He's completed the work of atonement and redemption and forgiveness and grace and mercy. And he's finished that. And now he's completed that. And he's making this announcement that that's the end. But this is the beginning of newness through me. Well, that's exciting. That's what Easter really is about. And so we read that word, it's finished. And it's not a statement of an end of departure, but it's an announcement of the fullness of the Lord. So God turns endings into new beginnings. God turns endings into new beginnings. You know, that's what, I think that's what God still does today, don't you? Oh, since he's the same yesterday, today, forever. And here's what I believe in that. You know, that's what he does in our lives here. You know, it may be 3 a.m. in your life where it's dark and you're stumbling around and, you know, like the women that are going to the tomb of Jesus, they're going to a death scene. And maybe you kind of feel like that way in your life. You know, there's no life in your, there's no sense of direction. You go, what am I here for? Just everything seems like death around me. What a drudgery. You kind of dread going there. Just like the ladies, they saw Jesus. They knew they were about to wipe all the blood off his face and off his brow and off his whole body because he was torn from head to toe when the Romans took their whip and just ripped his back open and all that. It's a bloody mess, and the crown and the nails in his hands, and he just really bled out on this thing. And so they're going to a mess, and they didn't want to go there, but they're going. Maybe that's how you feel. You know, it's dark in your life, and you're stumbling around. You don't have a direction. You dread life. You go in, everything around you, just a sense of deadness. That's what the women felt like, and maybe that's what you felt. You see, also the women also understood that their hope, all of their hope, was in this man Jesus, and he's dead. So they had no hope. So where are the ladies going? They go in this tomb where their hope was, and once was alive, and they trusted him, and they believed in him, and they all their hope was him, and now he's dead, and so that dead hope, they're going to have to go. They're dreading this journey. Every step they take. Maybe that's you. Maybe that's you this morning. Just your life, you go, man, I just hate my life. Every day I wake up and I go, man, nothing in my life. You're no substance, no direction. Just all this kind of. Look up your eyeballs. Remember this. God turns endings into new beginnings. Amen?
Amen.
Hear this. Just hear this. God turns endings into new beginnings. He turns buried situations into resurrection. Whatever's in your life right now, you know, it's just kind of sealed with that. Man, you're not touching that. It's death. It's destruction. You know, let me tell you what God says. I can take that death, that burial, and bring life to it. So that's the situation that's going on. Now we're going to talk about the conflict. Okay, we'll come back to this, but I want to talk about the conflict. You know, every good book or every good movie has conflict in it, right? Yeah. You don't go to watch a movie, you know, a guy wants to buy a car, so he buys, you know, a station wagon car, he gets it, makes a down payment, and that's the movie, right? We want to see conflict there. Then when he gets there, somebody else buys it, and then, you know, he sneaks, you know, anyway, that's conflict. So how about Andy Griffith? Anybody know Andy Griffith?
Yeah.
How many of y'all like Andy Griffith's show, you know? Man. No, some of y'all don't like that. Wow. You know, Andy Griffith, it's every episode that you watch Andy Griffith, whatever. There's always a conflict, isn't there? Always a conflict, you know? Andy falls in love for a guy and he's a shyster, you know? Or Opie, my favorite one, when you know, he takes a slingshot and you know, he's just kind of shooting and he hits a llama and kills her. You let me finish. A mama bird, he kills him. Yeah, he shoots him out, he kills his mama bird, and now he's got to raise these birds. Remember that? Tell me about that one? Yeah. Andy, I've got to get out more often. And so he you know, kills us, and you know, Andy, the conflict resolver, comes to him, and you know, he says, well, you got to take care of these birds, and they raise them, and then they fly off out of the cage, and Opie says, man, does that cage look empty? And then what does Andy say? He says, but boy, does it? Aren't the trees full? Because the birds are singing up there. Isn't it cool? Yeah. I'm 40 out of here. Anyway, so any book that you read in movies, you know, and some of you chick flick people out there, you know, like the boy wants the girl, you know, and the boy can't have the girl because the girl's got a boyfriend, and the boyfriend finds out that this guy likes him, so he gets beat up, the conflict hurts, you know, and then finally she feels sorry for him or something happens, and you know, something big happens and the conflict arises, and finally he gets the girl, you know, it's a chicken thing. And then so this guy, the one girl, gets the girl, and then really the conflict begins again, you know. But just kidding, ladies. But anyway, so every good story is conflict. And now we've got some conflict. Look at verse 3. We're going to see this conflict that's going on in this story. Okay? Here it is. And they were saying to one another, you know, who will roll the stone away from us? I mean, so. That's a pretty good question. I love this story. You know, here's some ladies, and I don't see any guys around here too, by the way, guys. Here's some ladies. And they're doing what they know to do. The only thing that they can do, they don't know where to go. They're just like some of us here, we don't know what to do in life. We just go to work. We just do the best we can in life. And at the end of the day, we go, well, love's out of that. That's what they're doing. They're doing this. But I love this story because notice what they're doing. As they're going along, they start planning this. And I think personally they asked some guys to help them. But nobody did. So we're going. So they're off and they're walking down this road. And as they're walking on this long, dreadful journey of pain and agony and really dealing with their lives and their sense of hopelessness, here's what happened. They begin to wonder who's going to remove the stone away from us. We can't do it. Who's going to do that? I love you guys because you know what? Y'all are multitaskers. Men, we have no idea. We can't even spell that word, can we? We can't do two things at one time. Ladies, y'all can do this. It's amazing what y'all can do. I remember in high school, a bunch of guys got together and said, let's go camping. And so we went camping and we got out there in the middle of nowhere. You know, we're shooting rabbits and living in West Texas. We could do that, you know, legally. But anyway, so we're shooting rabbits and all this, and so we get to the campfire and we go, who brought the food? We look around, nobody brought food. We're teenagers. We go, nobody brought food. So we didn't plan that. So we did what any teenager would do. We said, let's go hunt some. We're going to kill it and eat it, right? So we get out there and we kill a cottontail. You don't need jackrabbits. Those are nasty. But anyway, we shoot this cottontail, and I reach into this bush, and I reach in there, and all of a sudden this bush comes alive. There's a rattlesnake in there, a 4.5-foot rattlesnake. And I jump back and I tell the guys, and we're just like, cowboys at the OK Corral. We all get a gun, and we shoot. There's not a leaf on that bush, but we kill that rattlesnake. And then we realize, well, we got a rattlesnake. We're hungry. We do what teenagers do. We went to the all-night cafe and got a hamburger. And we left the rattlesnake outside of the parking lot to scare somebody. That's what we did. But see, men, we're not multitaskers, but the ladies are. Here's what they're doing. They're walking on this road, and they're thinking, who's going to roll this stone? We can't. Scholars tell us about that. That stone was probably from 4 feet to maybe 6 feet in diameter. It's the stone. So that tells us, you do the math at home, whatever you want to do, but that tells us that weighed from 1 to 2 tons. That's a lot of weight. And also when they did this, they made it in a groove. This was a common tune that they would do that in a lot of times, you know. And so and when they rolled the stone, you could roll it back easily because it was on the incline, but to roll it off, or to roll it, you know, where it's already been closed and out so you can go in, was very difficult because it was on this incline. And it had a little catch on there, so you had to lift it over there. So three ladies, two strong men even could do this. It took 3 or 4 men to roll this thing. And so they're asking this question. They know that they can't roll this stone. Why? It's too damn heavy. You got that? All right. And so they're kind of asking this. Pretty good question, really. Who's going to roll this obstacle, right? That's probably a lot of us in this room. I mean, we got these obstacles in our lives. And you know, we're doing what we're supposed to do. Just like these ladies, they're going to do what they can do. They're doing what they can do, and yet there's obstacles in their lives. They're just trying to do the best they can, trying to make a bad situation into a good situation, trying to do something in their life, and then there's these obstacles. Stones, you can't move. I dare say that a lot of us in this room, man, that's me. It's me right there. I have things in my life, I just can't do it. Maybe you come today and you say, man, today I want a passion for God. I hope this preacher can really help me up because I want a passion for God. I used to love God and serve God, but I lost that. And there's obstacles in my life. It can be different obstacles. It could be broken relationships with your past. It could be, you know, addictions of drugs, or it could be addictions of food. It could be addictions of gossip and lying and lust. It could be all these addictions out there. You say, man, I'd really be a good servant for God, but man, I've just got these obstacles. I've got these stones in my life. And I've tried to do them. I can't do that anymore. I can't get rid of them. I can't remove them. And so most of us in this room, we say, you know, we're trying to do the best we can. And then we ask, man, is there somebody that can remove these obstacles, these addictions, these struggles, these angers, this depression, gossip, and past failures and sorrows and anger and all this, is who can move this stone? I can't do it. story continues. The story continues because it says that there's a mystery here. The mystery is this, in verse 4. You know, I love mysteries, and I like reading mysteries because it kind of gets my attention, you know. And I read a lot of different stuff, most of theology books and things like that, and like law books, but anyway, that's the story. But so in this reading here, you know, I read this and there's kind of the mystery. And here's this mystery, you know. We can't move this stone. We know we can't move this stone, so what now? Verse 4 tells us. Look what now? Look there. And looking up, say that with me, and looking up. One more time. And looking up. Tells me, man, they're just walking, maybe in shame or disappointment, or really dealing with, you know, we came to that stone, and we can't do it. And then, in looking up, they saw that the stone had been broken, because it was a monster. We couldn't do it. Isn't that great? I love the detail of this story. And so it says this, and so, you know, it's true today, you know, that's the truth of this mystery. Here's the truth of this mystery. God had already got to the tomb before they did, and he took care of the obstacle. Isn't that cool? God gets there before they did, and he removes the obstacle that they couldn't move. That's Easter, church. You know that? That is so Easter. That's true today because here's some things in your life, probably, and in my life. There are things, probably, there's obstacles in your life that are keeping you from God. There's obstacles in your life that just says, you know, I really want a closer relationship with God, but I've got these things in my life that are blocking me from really knowing God. And these obstacles kind of keep you from going, just like the last one they showed there, man, we got this stone, it's going to keep us from seeing Jesus here and doing what we need to do for him. And so this obstacle keep that from them. And notice what this God shows up, knowing that they can't remove the stone. And God shows up and takes care of that obstacle and that barrier. And that's the message of Easter, really is. Look up here. Here's the next one. Here it is. Check this out. Hey, check this out. This is so cool. Don't let any barriers keep you from coming to God, because God has already removed. Do not let anything keep you. You know, anything in your life that you think of, that you, maybe a reality and a struggle that you have in your life, don't allow any of those barriers to keep you from going to God, because God has already taken care of any barrier in your life. You understand that? That's resurrection right there. And I know that maybe that's just really not deep in you, because here's what it is. God is stronger than your struggles. And here's what happens to a lot of us. Here's what we do. We come to obstacles in our life, and we begin to just kind of manhandle that thing, right? So, man, you know, it's my problem, and I'm going to deal with that, and I'm going to get rid of this addiction, I'm going to get rid of this anger, I'm going to get rid of this conflict in my life, this thing that keeps me from the presence of God. I'm going to deal with this, and we push, and we push, and we say, well, that's not working. I'm going to get on the other side for another 10 more years, right? And so we're going to push on this, and we shove, and we can't do it ourselves. You don't understand that. We can't do it. You can try all you want to, but you can't. Never be able to remove those stones. And we try and we push and we pull and we're strong with this. Remember this. Check this out. Heaven's answer to I can't because of that stone in your life, because of that sin, that failure, that past hurt that maybe you caused or maybe you didn't. Whatever you're struggling with this morning, when you're on this road and wanting to know Jesus and wanting to be with him, and you come to that stone and you say, I can't remove that. I've had that so long in my life. It's been a part of my family life. It's this curse in our life. I can't remove it. I want you to know that this is the truth, that heaven's answer to I can't because is God has already taken care of that. Amen? God has already taken care of that. He's already dealt with that. Any sin that you have, God's taking care of it. Any failure you have, God's taking care of that. All of any anger that you have, or disappointments, or brokenness, or sorrow, or depression, or loneliness, God has taken care of every barrier that would ever keep you from knowing Him and serving Him and loving Him and having a relationship with Him. Do you understand? That's Easter. These ladies found that out when they got to the tomb and realized that He was not there. Look at the mystery kind of continues in verses 5 through 7. Let me read this to you. So the ladies entered the tomb. Why? Because God had what? Removed the stone, right? God enabled them to come into this tomb. And they saw a young man sitting on the right side dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. You might kind of agree with that. You might get a witness on that, you know? You might see an angel before. Oh, my goodness. I love what the angel says. This is pretty cool right here. And the angel says to them, do not be alarmed. Are you kidding me? Really? Well, it's not everybody see an angel. They come in there. They're already stressed out to the max. They haven't slept all night. They've been dreading what they're about to do. Stress levels high and all this. And then they come to the tomb. They go, well, what is this? They really don't fully understand that God is taking care of the stone. And so they go into the, they go inside there and they see an angel. Are you kidding me? He said, hey, don't worry about this. I got this. That's what the angel said to them. Yeah. I love that part. Yeah. You don't be alarmed. You seek Jesus from Nazareth. He's crucified. Notice what it says. He is risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him, and there's a specific place where they laid Jesus, and they knew this. They understood the ritual part of that. And so he's no longer there. But go and tell the disciples and tell Peter that he is going before you to Galilee, and you will see him just as he has told you. So the mystery solved, isn't it? He's not here. He's risen. Still a lot of questions, still a lot of confusion, but the mystery of the empty tomb is that Jesus is alive. Do you get that? Everything hinges on this. Jesus would be alive. He would not be who He says He is had He not risen from the dead. The reason we are here today is that Jesus is alive. Do you understand that? You may not think that, believe that, but trust me, the whole universe is hinges around this. Every hope that you might have, every promise of forgiveness, every promise of a future life, of resurrected life, of life after life, and life after death, is based on this very thing, that Jesus is not here. He's risen. Everything. Let me show you scripture verse real quick. Alright? Real quick. 1 Corinthians. Paul is writing to the Corinth church. The Corinth church is a mess. They have derailed. They have a good heart, but they've just derailed. There's a lot of things going on in that church, a lot of conflict. And let me tell you, this is the centrality of this church. This church is not built on programs. This fellowship is not built on people. This fellowship is not built on the way that we want to do things. This church, Wimberley Christian Church, is built upon the principle that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. And everything we do, everything that we say, every action that we take, every ministry that we have is based on that fact that Jesus is alive, He is real, and He is the only way unto the Father by His grace and mercy. And that's what we base this on. Well, the Corinth church is arguing this. They said, well, maybe it didn't happen, maybe it didn't. And they're arguing with one another. And notice what Paul says to settle this, how important it is for the Christian church to move on. Here's what he says. And if Christ had not been raised, then our preaching is in vain. And your faith is in vain. It's worthless. So it doesn't matter how much faith you have, or how much I preach to you, it's all in vain. It doesn't mean a dadgum thing unless Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. That's what it says. We are found to be misrepresenting God, because we've testified about God, that He has raised Christ, whom He did not raise. If it were not true that the dead are not even raised at all. In other words, he said, this thing that you think that you're going to have life after death, it means nothing at all if Jesus did not rise from the dead. And guess what? Your belief, your thought, even how good you may think you are, you're not going to get that because Jesus did not rise from the dead. So everything is hinged on your afterlife, your hope for the future. The promise that you're going to stand before God and be forgiven is all hinged on the fact that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Next. For the dead are not raised. Not even Christ has been raised. Christ has not been raised. Your faith is useless. And guess what it says right there? You're still in your sins. Then those who also fall asleep in Christ are perishing. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. In other words, what he's saying is we base all of our hope. We can't wake up in the morning as followers of Christ not knowing that this is not true, because we don't have any hope. Our life means nothing. We don't be pitied that we even consider this thing called Christianity, because it's alive, Jesus is not risen from the dead. Do you see what Paul is saying here? He said everything hinges on this, it's so important. And here's what happened. The mystery of the empty tomb has been solved. And here's what we've done so far, okay? I've given this backdrop of this story. I told you about the conflict that's going on. And then we also talked about the mystery of who rolled the stone away and what's that about, and then it's solved. And then we're going to talk about the action of this story. And I don't know about you, but I like action movies. You know, I'm just a guy. I like action movies. You know, I love a lot of action, you know, things blowing up. It just moves me to tears to see things that are blown up. You know, I love movies that are action. You know, anybody up here? And most movies are pretty good movies with a lot of action, but some movies really aren't very good. You know, Waterworld. Cowboys and Aliens, that's, you know, a lot of action, but just not very good movies. So here's where we're going to talk about the action here, but we're going to go to another book because John is involved in this, and he kind of details it. So if we look at John chapter 20, verses 1 through 6. Yeah. Here's the action part. There's a lot of running here in this story. I mean, the action begins now, okay? Everything's been set up, the mystery's been solved, and now they're going to have to deal with this. Now the drama becomes, and now everybody's starting to run, you know? You see in verse 1 that it talks about how Mary's seen this, and she's told by the angel to go back and tell the guys. And then if you read that up there, it says that she takes off what? Running, man. It's like Chariots of Fire story movie here. You know, everybody's running in this thing, you know? So they start running, and she runs to them, and she begins to tell them this story of what she's seen, because she's obedient to what God, the angel had told her to do, and so she comes there. And then let me pick this up. So she ran and went to Peter, the other disciples whom Jesus loved. Who's that? Anybody know? What? It's John. There you go. That's John there. And said to them, see, John is led by the Holy Spirit. He's writing this story. So he just mentioned himself right here. So she comes and she tells Peter, and then she says, she tells the disciple of Jesus, that's me. See what? Y'all got that? You got that? No cookies for y'all. Have y'all got that? Okay. So John is writing this down. Let's take a moment with this. And then, so John is writing this in whom the disciple loved. That's me he's talking about. And so he says, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb. We don't know where they laid him. So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. And both of them were what? Yeah, they started running. Now here's what I think. I think Peter got a head start on this place. And the reason I think this was because he's called presumptuous Peter. Peter's always the first one. You know, he's the first one to talk, first one to volunteer, first one to do this. You know, first one, he would always answer the question. You know, ooh, 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 ooh. Remember those kids in class? Didn't you hate them? You know, he was presumptuous. I got this, I need this, I want to do this. You know, he was one of those guys, okay? So he's presumptuous. He was always the first one. So here's what I think. When Peter heard this, you know, remember, he's the one that jumped out of the boat, said, in the storm, hey, can I walk on the water, you know? And it didn't work out very well. He got a little ways, more than God did, but he got a little ways. And so then, you know, remember when Jesus has been resurrected, they see him, he jumps over the boat and swims to the shore. I mean, so that's why I think Peter he takes off running immediately. And he takes off running. And then notice what I said, remember who's writing this, John, by the Spirit of God. Let me look at verse 5. But the other disciple outran Peter and reached to the tomb first. I love that. See, so what happened was they're all sitting there, and all of a sudden she comes in, and Peter jumps up, and everybody watches Peter take off, and John goes, oh my gosh, she's got a head start. And he takes off running, and then he says, yeah, but when we got there, I beat him. You know? Y'all see? Y'all have got to wake up here. I mean, John just says, yeah, he took off first, but I beat him, so I got there first. Oh, this is kind of like that. See, the Bible's kind of fun, really. Really, you gotta read it sometime. You know, just dust it off. You know, remove all the corsages you ladies have put in there, you know, and keep sex from the grandkids, and dust it off, and read the Bible, because there's a lot of cool things in there, so, all right? said, "I'll ditch it." Let me tell you what I really jumped into. Let me tell you about that. Here they are. Get the picture. They hear that somebody's taking Jesus. They're not sure. So you talk about angels, all this stuff. He goes, "What?" He takes off running. He's excited. And he's running as fast as he can. Can you just picture, man? He's running. He goes, "Man, this, man, God, what happened? I wonder what happened." And the more that he runs, the more he thinks, "Uh-oh. Man, last time I saw Jesus, I denied him. Man, he said I was going to deny him. And I was such a big shot. I said, well, somebody will deny me." Jesus said, "Somebody's going to deny me in this group." He said, "No, not me. I'm the big boy here. I'm not going to deny you." But he's upset. I saw him beat and scourged and abused and mocked. I saw that. And I did nothing. I was just thinking to myself. So rather than running at lightning speed, all of a sudden he starts slowing down. Hang on, I don't know. See Jesus. And what's he going to say to me? I have a lot of things that he probably was not going to do. I mean, what I did to him, I betrayed him. I disowned him. The closer he gets, the more he kind of slows down. Maybe before Mary showed up there, he all that, maybe he's sitting in the corner thinking all the shame and the guilt that he had. And he said, "Man, why would I do this?" And all the guilt is in him, and he just feels so guilty about how he betrayed Jesus and disowned him and turned his back. And maybe you're here this morning. Listen, maybe you're here this morning that you've done some things that you just never knew Mr. God could ever forgive you. I mean, you've done some things, and you know, maybe nobody else knows, and maybe you've hurt others, and maybe there's just these barriers that keep you from God because you know God probably wouldn't forgive you for ever doing something. So that keeps you from seeking the Lord. Just kind of standing back from you. And what happens a lot of times, we place all those sins, all those failures, all those disappointments, all that anger, all those things, we put them in a grave, and we bury them, we put a stone on ourselves over there. We say, "We're not going to touch that. We're not going to talk about that. We're not going to deal with that. We're just going to ignore that." Because you drive all that baggage with you all the time. And all in your mind, you're thinking, "Man, will he ever forgive me?" Well, let me tell you something. That empty tomb changes everything. The empty tomb says, "I forgive you." The empty tomb says, "I forgive you." Remember this verse we read a while ago? Let me just kind of refer back to it. 1 Corinthians 15, 17. It says, "If Christ is not raised, your faith is meaningless. And you are still in your sin." See, forgiveness of our sin is the foundation of our hope for any other blessings that we'll ever get from God. Last Sunday, I'm almost here at this time. Last Sunday, we talked about the Day of Atonement. In the Old Testament, what they would do, and God orchestrated this, he said, "One day a year, I want you to take, on the eighth day of the month, I want you to take all the sins of Israel." And the high priest would come, and he would take all the sins of all of Israel. They'd been confessing those sins, things that they had to hold for one whole year, because there's no other way to confess sins. That was the Day of Atonement. That was the Day of Confession. So a whole week they would spend just agonizing over their sins, all the things and mistakes they'd done for that whole year. And they knew the high priest was going to make this sacrifice, and that all their sins was going to be placed on that goat, and that goat was going to be led out of town, and they would be forgiven. Talked about that last Sunday, the fulfillment of Jesus. Because Jesus becomes that scapegoat. And all of mankind, it seems, is placed on Jesus. And see, Peter understood that. Because all of his life, he's seen that ceremony of the high priest coming and all of his sins and all of Israel's sins being placed on that goat, the goat being led out of Jerusalem. And later, we found out that he was killed out in the wilderness. But all of that sin and all of that unforgiveness was placed on his head. And as the goat left, we felt like all the people of Israel go, "Forgiven. One year I'm going to hold this in. And now then I shared a little bit of an interesting thing, that they would take that rope that was tied around that goat that was blessed, and they'd already dyed it red, but I'm sure it symbolizes the judgment of God, that there had to be a sacrifice. And so the rope that led Jesus out of town in the clothes that saturated symbolized that same experience of that goat being led out in the sins of the sacrifice being made. And Jesus says, in that scripture verse, John, who wrote that by the Holy Spirit, says that had I not raised from the dead, your sins would not be forgiven. And Peter, when he looked in that tomb, if you read that last part, he believed. Why did he believe? Look up here. He knew he was forgiven. And there was hope. If you don't hear anything else I say, this is it. This is Easter. This is Easter. Christ sacrificed himself. No man took his life. He willingly laid it down. He sacrificed himself so that you and myself and all who believe in him and trust him and yield their life through faith might be forgiven. Now, you see, all the barriers that you built between you and God, they've all been removed through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Why would he do that? God would do whatever he wants to. This is because he wants to have a relationship with us. And the barrier is our sin, our rebellion, our disbelief, our pushing God away. And after year in your life and in my life, we push him away to the point where we remove that barrier. You must, by faith, accept what I've done. True grace, gift from God. And that is, believe me. Believe me. I don't know about you, but I believe that Jesus Christ rose again.
Amen.
My whole ministry, my whole life is based on that. My last breath, I will preach that, and I will teach that, and I will live that. And here's the last question. This resurrection thing, it's a great story. It's a true story. What difference does it make in your life? I mean, really? What difference does it really make? You may walk out today, have Easter with your family, kids are out having fun with eggs and all that. But when you leave those doors, what difference does this message mean to you? What difference does the resurrection of Jesus Christ really mean in your life? Does it change everything about you? Or is it just another holiday or something? Maybe today you just come on Mary and the two Marys and slowly and just, you know, it's just a ritual, you know, to they went to anoint Jesus. Oh, that's just a ritual. Maybe today just going to church is just a ritual. So what is it? Answer this question in your life. Does the resurrection of Jesus make a difference in my life every single day of my life? This is for believers and not yet believers, and seekers in this room. The moment you believe, the moment you yield your life, is the moment you'll understand this mystery about God, because Christ lives, and he lives in you, and that is our hope for glory. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.